also feel the responsibility of being the first speaker, so I will try to make a bit of introduction to the field of iron-based superconductor, in particular iron selenium, that is the main topic of the talk. I also would like to thank the co-worker in this project, from the theory side, Laura Fanferillo and Belen Valenzuela, who were really the driving force to bring me back to iron pink ties after a few years, Emanuele Cappelluti for work we did in the past, and recent time experimental collaboration with Veronique Brouet in Paris. So the first point I would like to try to convince you that there was a good idea to start this workshop with a session on iron selenium. Because even if not everybody here live and breathe iron selenium as some of the speakers in the and people in the audience, this is a nice system. It belongs to the family of iron-based superconductor, which are actually not particularly correlated materials, in the sense that these are metallic systems. There are correlations, but we are really far from the real Mottness that we see, for example, in other systems like heavy fermions or cuprates. Indeed, the Fermi surface predicted by density functional theory agrees in a qualitative level, at least with the experimental measurement. And this is also a relatively low TC superconductor, which is a TC of 9 Kelvin. So apparently, this is not a good system to start with this workshop. But actually, there is something much more than this. This is true, it's a metallic system. It has a very strong pneumatic behavior. And then I will try to explain what is pneumaticity, at least in the way we try to decline, if you want, this word. And then the Fermi surface is true, agrees qualitatively with the FT, but there are a remarkable quantitative disagreement due to the fact the Fermi surface is much smaller than what has been predicted. And then this low TC superconductor is the one in the family of iron pink ties, where it's much more difficult to explain the gap anisotropy. And this is one issue that several theory groups are fighting on recently. So in some sense, iron selenium exasperates all the passing effects that are there in general in iron-based superconductor. And this is why it's interesting, and this is why there are so many people that are really trying to push this problem in the last few years. So to try to understand why iron selenium is particular, let me also make a very brief introduction to the physics of pink ties. You will have a lecture next week, so for the student, don't try to understand everything, just to catch some ideas, not to be lost in all the talks that you will have in this week. These are materials which are made by layers of iron and arsenide, or iron and selenium, with other layers in between. The phase diagram is similar somehow to what we have seen in other correlated systems. So when you dope the system, there is a first magnetic state, which goes over, then superconductivity appears. This system is made by multiband. So if you take the typical iron one iron unit cell, you will have several pockets made by hole-like and electron-like pockets here. At the gamma point, there are two hole pockets, and X or Y point that are electron ones. The real, the physical unit cell actually is made by two iron atoms, because arsenide or selenium atoms lie above or below the iron planes, which means that the real unit cell is double bigger, which means that is twice smaller in a reciprocal Brillouin zone, and then the electron pocket gets folded there. So in most of the experimental talk, you will see electron pocket at gamma and at M, and in most of the theory talk, we will take this one iron Brillouin zone notation because it's easier to explain some physics that will appear later on. Now, the fact that we have hole-like and electron-like pockets, since the very beginning, suggests that the origin of spin density wave superconductivity in this system can be explained in a very simple argument. So I'm really oversimplifying here just to get an idea. You have hole-like and electron-like pockets, a different point of the Brillouin zone. Now, these pockets are nested, which means that if you take the hole-like dispersion, you displace by Q, you get a dispersion which is minus the dispersion of the electrons. This condition, which is called nesting, makes the susceptibility in the particle hole channel, which is the typical Lindert function here, completely analogous to the pair susceptibility, the Cooper susceptibility, which is a logarithmic divergence at low temperature. This means that any interaction in this channel essentially will lead to a divergence to the RPA susceptibility in the spin sector, for example. So this just basic structure explains why spin density wave is possible, and it will involve a spin fluctuation at the large vector Q connecting hole-like and electron-like pocket. Very simple argument. And when you dope the system, the Fermi level moves, so you go out from nesting, so the spin instability is gone, but there are residual interactions between hole-like and electron-like pocket, which are mediated by residual spin fluctuation. And this can be a glue for pairing, and this pairing will lead to S plus minus a superconducting ordered parameter, in the sense that if you now you want to solve this couple BCS equation, where this is the gap in the electron pocket and this is the gap on the hole pocket, since interactions are repulsive, you get a change of sign of these two ordered parameters to satisfy the equation. So this is a very, very, very simple argument, but this kind of argument were proposed from the very beginning by several people. And the reason why actually this mechanism works is because even if the real band structure of this material is very complicated, at low energy, this band picture works pretty much well. So these are the real, like, somehow microscopic models which describe iron selenium. You see you have several orbitals. These are the orbitals of the iron atoms. They are split by crystal field having low energy orbitals in XZ, YZ, XY. But density the MFT calculation somehow show that this picture works more or less well once that you overall renormalize the bandwidth of the electronic state with respect to the FT calculation. So somehow you can just squeeze your bands, and then you can end up with a low energy model, which is the one that I was showing before, with normalized effective mass, and this somehow provides a good description of the Fermi levels physics. Yes? Maybe you need the microphone.
Yes, I will give you a microphone.
Maybe.
When you ask questions, just stand up so everyone can hear you better.
Sure.
The microphone, problem. Yeah.
Is that a rule to shout here?
Okay.
So I guess my question is that in FESE, there's actually a statement about the incoherent bands.
Yes. Yes, what I'm saying is that it's not everything is not captured by the low energy model, but let's say the near to the Fermi level, there are enough coherent quasi-particle. Then I will discuss later if we can have the different levels of coherence and different orbitals. But let's start from the general assignment that, let's say, there are normalization. There is a splitting, for example, between XY and the doublet of XZ, YZ, but there are Fermi surface state. And ARPES does see Fermi surface state. That you can see the hole pocket and electron pocket. At least in most of iron pink ties, there is no doubt about this. Then iron selenium has some peculiarity, and we will discuss it more. So let's say that these low energy models are not, especially once that you normalize the masses, you don't take the bare one, the FT. You take squeezed bands, it works.
Just to follow up on this.
Yeah.
So I guess the question is whether, you know, what constitutes low energy effective theory, right? So
when
you say going from high energy to low energy.
Oh, yes, sorry. So what I mentioned somehow is this one. You see the real bands, DFT will go up to 3 electron volts, okay? Then you normalize them by a factor 2 or 3, more or less, and you go up to 1 electron volt. What I'm going to discuss now in the following is what happens between, let's say, 0 and 500 millielectron volts. This is what I'm calling now low energy state. And these are the typical energy scale where you see superconductivity, nematicity, and so on and so forth. Then, of course, one has to be very careful and make this separation as a rigid one. But what I'm going to discuss in the next part of the talk is what happens in a range, let's say, 500 millielectron volts near to the Fermi level. So you can somehow renormalize your bands, and you can have a good description of this. Okay? Okay, let's go on. For example, this is just an example of what I mean it can work. So you can start from models, which are effective models at low energies, as I said, which fit more or less the disquisite band. You can compute the spin flotation at the level RPA. And then this is your starting model. You can compute spin flotation. You can compute the pairing symmetry coming out from this spin flotation. And you have more or less a good description of what's going on with the gap symmetry and the S plus minus order parameters. So this kind of calculation more or less are good both on a qualitative and quantitative level. So this is the reason why I'm saying this low energy model more or less works, with some remarkable exception that I will discuss later, in particular for Ilon Cirino. Okay, so far it's good. So what is so everything is simple. Actually, even in the, within this very simple scheme, where we have hollow-like and electron-like pockets, which are interacting thanks to spin fluctuation between them, one can have a very interesting physics. So having hole-like and electron-like bands with the predominant interband interaction, actually already at this level can lead to physics which is somehow unusual, so not conventional for a one-band superconductor. And this is a point we have been discussing over the years concerning several physical observable effects, like the band shrinking, anomalous Hall effect, very interesting features for the superconducting MOS. What I would like to discuss more today is this issue of the band shrinking, because this is one of the first puzzling effects that people have noticed in iron-based superconductor. As I told you before, DFT more or less reproduce the topology of the Fermi surface on these materials. But the real band, as they are measured, for example, in the Aswan Alpha, have pockets much smaller than prediction. Okay? So this shrinking of the Fermi surface has nothing to do with the band normalization. So if you change the mass of the band, it doesn't mean that you change the Fermi surface area. You're just changing the slope, which is the Fermi velocity. Okay? So this is a picture that is not usually captured by the dynamical mean field theory. And this is in the Aswan Alpha, it's also observed in arc-based measurement. So it looks like your bands are shifted up and down, giving rise to smaller Fermi surface. And of course, this is, since this is semi-metal, you still preserve the number of electrons, so this effect doesn't violate the number conservation. So a very simple way somehow to explain this effect is to consider the coupling of this electron with this residual spin fluctuation. And this can be done within the Liashberg approach, where essentially you compute the self-energy of the electrons interacting with the collective bosonic mode, which is here modeled as the typical spin fluctuation spectrum. But what is important and peculiar to Pnictides as compared to other systems is that the bands here are almost empty, which means that you are doing a Liashberg calculation, relaxing the usual assumption of infinite bandwidth, and this gives rise to a real part of the self-energy at finite at zero frequency, which leads to essentially to a band shift of the electrons. And again, the main mechanism will be still Hall interacting with electrons, because the main exchange is the interband one. And this is very interesting, because actually, if when you try to do this calculation, so we do full numerical calculation, where you can estimate in approximate way how large is this shrinking, this self-energy, you see it depends on the asymmetry of the band. So the distance of the band top or bottom from the Fermi level. The sign of the shrinking depends on the character of interaction in this sense. If you start from a Hall-like band, then you ask yourself, what is the effect of the self-energy on the change of the Fermi wave vector? You have two possibilities. If the band has a strong intraband interaction, so somehow the band fills itself, this can be a typical mechanism if you're interacting with the phonons, for example, the total sign of the shift is positive, so the band would expand. And this is, for example, a mechanism that we recently invoked to explain some pump probe experiments in GB2. But if the interaction have a dominant interband character, so the whole-like band sees somehow the effect in the electron-like band, and then this number change sign is negative, and then you have a shrinking of the Fermi surface. So having an expansion of shrinking of the Fermi surface somehow gives you indication if the dominant interaction are intraband or interband. And in the case of Pnictides, we try just to do calculation, a very simple model, so parabolic bands, no orbital character. This is a work back in 2009. And then we just remodeled the interaction as interband ones. And then you see essentially the shrinking of the Fermi surface. The white lines are the bare bands. The color plot is the spectral function for the normalized ones. And then you see this shrinking of the of the Fermi surface. So somehow the most likely candidate for this interband interaction are, of course, spin fluctuation, or if you want, the systematic observation of shrinking evening tides is an indication of relevance of interband fluctuation, interband interaction, and the most likely candidate are spin fluctuation. This effect is temperature dependent because the spin fluctuation itself are temperature dependent. If you move up in temperature, somehow the spin must go over, and then the self-energy correction becomes smaller, and then the effective size of the Fermi surface becomes larger. Somehow the pockets are expected to expand as the temperature increases. And then this is actually has been seen again in APES experiment. These are data from Veronique Wei 1-2 materials back in 2013. And then Sergei Borisenko, who will give the next talk, just a second, has also seen the same in iron selenium with a very, very strong, effect here. Yes? Microphone? Yes, your computer self consists of the chemical potential. But here, in any case, we have hololike and electron-like bands. So if you shift them in this way, the total number of electrons is preserved.
So, that's constant.
Yes, but you have to compute that, of course. You're right. Okay, and probably Sergei will tell more about this later on in the talk. So just a final remark. So this Fermi surface shrinking is a kind of probe of the T-dependence of spin fluctuation. This has very interesting profound implication for the optical sum rule, which is the point that we discussed mostly in this paper here. But I will not mention it now. Okay, so this is nice, but all this was done in the completely banned language, neglecting any orbital degrees of freedom. And this is not the whole story, of course. So orbital degrees of freedom are very important. And this is already this high energy normalization that Chimiao was mentioning before are very important and orbital dependent. So this is somehow orbital degrees of freedom cannot be neglected. But the point where people really started to struggle about orbital degrees of freedom is the case of nematicity in iron selenium. Because here everything becomes very somehow complicated. And this picture of spin fluctuation seems to fail at the first look. Why this? First of all, what is nematicity? In these materials, we have a structural transition from tetragonal to orthorhombic. As I said before, you have your basic unit cell is made of iron atoms. In the high temperature phase, the system is tetragonal, which means that the two lattice directions are equivalent. Below the structural transition, one direction becomes longer than the other. So this is just a change in the lattice structure. Of course, the change in the lattice structure is expected to give indication in the electronic behavior. But the point is that what you do see in the experiment, here, for example, are resistivity measurement, you get an anisotropy in resistivity across the structural transition here, which is extremely larger than what you can expect from a simple change of a few percent of the length of the two bonds. Okay, and this is why people think about pneumatic. So somehow, this is an effect. Of course, there is always a connection between lattice and electronic degrees of freedom. But the main idea is that maybe are the electronic degrees of freedom themselves who drive the transition. And of course, if you want to say again in this picture of spin-mediated interaction, one possible candidate are the spin fluctuation themselves. Of course, this is an effect that you have to capture going beyond RPA. So you have to take interaction between spin mode to the fourth order. This is a beautiful work by Andre and Raphael back in 2018. So as I told you before, the basic interaction are between the gamma, the hole-like and the electron-like pocket. But you have two possible wave vectors which connect hole-like with electron-like pockets. And then for high gain, for temperature larger than the dynamic transition, these two directions are completely equivalent. Below the pneumatic transition, heat can happen. This can be driven by interaction beyond RPA, that fluctuation becomes stronger in one direction than in the other, without breaking spin symmetry. So there is no spin order parameter, but there are fluctuations stronger in one direction than the other. So in this picture, pneumatic transition means that you break the degeneracy between fluctuation at QX and QY. And this is a completely this electron-like mechanism for nematicity. And of course, this was a reasonable approach, especially in the case of 1-2 material, where the structural transition happens immediately before the spin density transition. So somehow spin nematicity is this breaking of the fluctuation is just preemptive to the magnetic state which is established for lower temperature. And indeed, in the magnetic state, you do see ordering for one specific direction of the Q vector for spin modes. Okay? And then this precursor of magnetic transition can be seen, for example, in Raman experiment, like an enhancement in a specific channel. We will have a couple of talks later on in the conference on this. And the same effect has been seen, actually, for example, in Raman, also in iron selenium. But what is puzzling here is that the orthorhombic transition, which happens here at 90 Kelvin, is not followed by magnetic transition. So somehow, the puzzle is why should I have a spin nematic transition if there is no magnetism appearing before? And magnetism actually only appears when you, for example, you dope the system with the pressure, but then you see spin density wave transition happens when nematicity is gone. So of course, iron selenium can be problematic from this point of view. And the second point is that in iron selenium, since there is this huge range of temperature where the system is nematic without any other transition, TC only happens for 9 Kelvin, people have seen in ARPES a very strong reconstruction of the Fermi surface. So this is, again, the Fermi surface I was showing before, Hall-like and electron-like. I'm adding now colors here, and the color cord is the main orbital character of each pocket, okay? So I have to take three main orbitals to describe the pockets of the Fermi level, XZ, YZ, and XZ. And then you see, when you will go below the structural transition, these pockets deform. The gamma one becomes elliptical, this one shrink, this one expand, and this can be reproduced in a kind of crystal field splitting for the orbitals. So it looks like you are taking your orbitals, they should be degenerating energy in the tetragonal phase. In the nematic phase, you have a kind of change of energy of the local occupation of XZ and YZ, and this change of energy also changes sign between gamma and M. So this is a very, very peculiar way of crystal field splitting. And then everything happens somehow in the particle channel. So of course, this triggered the idea that in iron selenium, nematicity has a different origin. Everything has to do with interaction in the particle channel. So spin wave interaction are gone. And this will be described, I think, in more detail by Indranil on Friday. Now, this, of course, is a possibility. And this is a complicated system. One cannot rule out any effect. But one point that we try to pursue is it possible to revise this very simple picture that I had before, adding the orbital degrees of freedom, and what is the consequence of this? And then when we did that, what we realized is that once that we construct our spin-mediated interaction, starting from the real description of the low energy with orbital degrees of freedom, we can still find a kind of one-to-one connection between spin fluctuation at different moments and the orbital character of the pocket. And this is what I will call orbital selective spin fluctuation. So let me try to give you an idea why there is this relation between spin and orbital degrees of freedom. And let's start again from a low energy model, where now I add the orbital content, as I told you before. So I'm still talking about Hall-like and electron-like pockets, but I take into account what is the orbital content of each pocket. Okay, then I want to play the same game as before, for example. Can I have a spin fluctuation between Hall-like and electron-like pocket, which are somehow enlarged due to the nesting condition? Okay, if I now start to build up my spin operator, taking into account the orbital character, this eta here is just an orbital index, when I do this particle bubble, I want to go from the Hall to the electron-like pocket, because I want to take into account of the nesting. And then I want to come back. This means that if I want to make a spin fluctuation between this Hall pocket and this electron pocket, I need to have the same orbital degrees of freedom on both of them. Otherwise, I cannot make this spin fluctuation Lindert bubble finite. And this implies that essentially, if I want to make fluctuation in the x direction, since only the YZ orbital is in common between the Hall-like and the electron-like pocket, the fluctuation along X only affects YZ, the YZ orbital. On the other end, when I make spin fluctuation in the other direction, the only orbital in common is xz, and then spin fluctuation for that q vector will only select orbital which is xz. And this is what I call orbital selective spin fluctuation. So somehow there is a one-to-one correspondence between the momentum of the spin mode and the character of the orbitals, which are affected by them. And then, of course, I can play the same game as before, for example, for the shrinking. So again, I want to compute a self-energy correction, but here I have to take into account the orbital character. So my self-energy will be somehow a matrix in the orbital, basis. In the hole pocket, I will have a yz and xz character. In the electron pocket, I will have yz and xy character. So again, I computed the spin fluctuation, the Eliasberg correction, as I did before. And since still the sign of the self-energy is due to the fact that I have interband character, so all band coupled to electron band, still I have the shrinking, as I had before. But now the shrinking becomes orbital selective because it is somehow, it can be in principle different in the two, in the two orbitals. Its spin fluctuation are different, OK? This is in the paramagnetic state, actually, these fluctuations are thought to be equivalent. And then the only effect that I have of this orbital selective shrinking is that I have somehow, I can just shrink so much the inner pocket that it goes below the Fermi level, as you can see here. And then you have some kind of enhanced elongation of this electron-like pocket due to the fact that I don't have spin-mediated interaction in the XY channel since the XY hole pocket is missing at the gamma point here. These are just the comparison between the calculation and the data by Veronique Bourret and Arion Selenium. Now, let's assume again that spin hermeticity in Arion Selenium is still due to this breaking of spin fluctuation in the two directions. So what happens within this model? What happens in this model is that since the orbital selective spin rotation are now different along x and y because of this spin nematic effect, then also the correction I have in the orbital sector will be different in the different orbitals, okay? So this, and the different sign of the self-energy at the hole-like and electron-like pocket also means that this orbital splitting will have a different sign at the gamma and m point. Okay? So somehow within this scenario, all that we observe as orbital ordering in the nematic phase of Arion Selenium can still be a consequence of spin nematicity if I take into account the self-energy correction of the electrons due to spin fluctuation. And this is somehow, so essentially with this kind of calculation, I can reproduce the typical kind of model that most of the people take as a starting point to reproduce nematicity in Arion Selenium. So these are just calculations we did to reproduce the data in Arion Selenium, the data by Veronique Bourret. So we model the spin fluctuation now in the pneumatic phase with different somehow spin masses and in the two directions. And we just found out that to reproduce observed splitting, we need a fluctuation stronger along x than along y. Okay, so spin pneumatic can still be the explanation of pneumaticity in Arion Selenium, even if what I do see is an orbital ordering at the end. Okay, let's go now to the last part, which is about superconductivity. And this is a really puzzle. Let me, yes. You have to go beyond RPA to reproduce spin nematicity. Here we took it in a phenomenological way. I will comment at the end if there is time about going beyond RPA. But you are right. So the question he's asking is the following. This propagator is the typical propagator of spin fluctuation. What gives you the difference in the masses has to come from an effect which goes beyond RPA. Okay. In this case, we took it as a phenomenological parameter. Okay, so we just say, let's say how different have to be the masses here to reproduce the experiment. Okay, perfect. Now, superconductivity. Now that we move from the band language to the orbital language, somehow it's obvious that also the superconductivity will have an orbital character. Okay, so orbital selective superconductivity here, it just means that if your band is made by different orbitals, of course your orbital, your superconducting order parameter in any pairing model which is written in the orbital basis will be orbital dependent. And then the total gap along the Fermi surface, for example, of the gamma pocket, will be just the combination of the orbital weights of each orbital, which I call here U and V, and then the superconducting order parameter. So this is just trivial. There is nothing particularly fancy in this. I mean, if you want to write superconductivity and you have orbitals, different orbitals on the Fermi surface, you have to take this into account, okay? So what is the real puzzle of iron selenium? When you go into the nematic phase, as I told you, the gamma pocket deform, it gets elongated in this direction. But also the orbital character changes considerably. So these are, for example, polarized Harpers experiment, but several groups agree on that. So the character of the pocket is almost completely XZ. So this crystal field splitting that you have in the nematic state completely remove the YZ character from the pocket, this becoming red. So this is just a sketch of the orbital character along the angle here. You see if in the paramagnetic state, in the nematic state. Okay. If you look at the experiment of the gap, these are data extracted from QPI quasi-particle interference in STM. The gap here on the gamma pocket is maximum at theta equal to zero, which is here, and it's minimum here, okay? So somehow the modulation of the gap follows the angular dependence of the subdominant YZ orbital, okay, which is this one. Because the main orbital, which is XZ, is a minimum at theta equal to zero, it is a maximum at pi over half. So the real puzzle of iron selenium is the following. You have, of course, a contribution of orbital degrees of freedom. You go in the pneumatic phase, you completely remove this character with respect to the other one. Okay? The pocket is almost completely XZ. But if you look at the gap, the symmetry of the gap is the gap of this orbital, the YZ. And then, if you really want to reconcile these two observations, you need the mechanism which makes the orbital component of the gap in the YZ channel much larger than the one in the XY channel, okay? Because you need somehow to overcome the Fermi surface reconstruction due to pneumaticity. And this is the big puzzle, okay? And this has been pointed out very clearly in several ARPES and data experiments in the last few months. So how to do that? Our proposal is to start to think again in the same way that we did before. We can just construct the model of the pair interaction based on the spin-mediated mechanism, pairing mechanism. Here you see this still, you have an interaction between a hollow-like pocket and electron-like pocket. This factor here just takes into account the orbital component and all of them. But what is very important that if you have a fluctuation stronger along this direction than in the other direction, also the pairing interaction has to be much stronger along X than along Y. So you need that also the pairing interaction is pneumatic. Otherwise, you cannot explain what's going on in the experiment. Why that? Let me just show you the data. Here, this dashed line are the solution of the self-consistent equation where I just take equal coupling, okay? So let's assume that it's spin-mediated pairing, but there is no nematicity in the spin-mediated interaction. Then gx is equal to gy, my language. And then in this solution gives me an orbital order parameter at the lower pocket, which is much smaller in the yz than xz. This orbital is also suppressed. Then at the end of the day, the gap just follows the modulation of the xz orbital, and then it has a maximum at pi over 2 instead of the minimum. But if I include a pneumatic fluctuation, and then I can overcome somehow this effect, this suppression of this orbital, and then I have an orbital parameter in the YZ channel much larger than XZ channel, and then the gap follows the symmetry of the subdominant YZ orbital, which is exactly the symmetry that you see in the experiment. Okay? So here it's crucial to have one coupling much larger than the other. Of course, this is not the same everywhere. For example, here, if I go to the Z pocket, in the Z pocket, which is the whole pocket measured in a different value of KZ in the Fermi surface, this pocket retains still a strong YZ orbital even in the pneumatic phase. Because, of course, how much you change the orbital content in a given pocket depends on the on the band parameter. Essentially depends on the Fermi level. This pocket is larger, so the pneumatic order has a smaller effect on the reconstruction of the Fermi surface, and then the YZ character is still there. In this case, of course, you don't have this strong imbalance of the two, and you can have a gain of the orbital character in the YZ respect to XZ channel already from the orbital ordering at the electron pocket. And this has been nicely explained by Andrei and Raphael in a recent PRL. So somehow, even without playing with the spin nematicity, so even taking the coupling equal in the two directions, you can reproduce the anisotropy that you observe experimentally. And this is the dashed line here. On the other end, if you add to this one also pneumatic pairing, which means GX larger than GY, you can have a much stronger anisotropy. And this could explain why the anisotropy that has been seen at the zeta pocket is larger than the anisotropy at the gamma pocket. And this probably will be shown in more detail by Sergei in the next slide. Of course, this effect is possible, but this effect is small if you want to use it for the gamma pocket. So if you only implement the effect of orbital ordering without nematicity for the gamma pocket, these are again the data by Andrei, you get a smaller anisotropy, but also the wrong sign of the anisotropy. So here, because here again, you are back to the problem I told you before. If you don't make this one much larger than the other, then you just follow the symmetry of the dominant orbital with the maximum at pi over 2 instead of the other one, okay? Now, there are, of course, other interesting proposals that have been done. One is to play with the effect of the spectral weights, okay? So this is the issue of the correlation. What happens if now the correlation, the different orbitals are not all the same, okay? The first proposal came actually from the same group of Seamus Davis, the calculation from Peter Ishfield, Brian Anderson, and others. The idea is how to explain these anisotropies you see experimentally. And then the author said, okay, let's try to implement now, to add to the orbital character, also the possible coherence of the various orbital, okay? I'm done. Okay. And then you have different weight in the different orbitals. And what did they say? Let's assume that the YZ orbital is much more coherent than the other two. Okay? This assumption has two effects. You move the maximum of the spin fluctuation from pi pi to pi zero, as you can see here. So somehow you make, in effective way, interaction much larger than in the X direction than the Y direction. And this gives you also an orbital ordering which is much larger than the other one, and this explains the symmetry of the experiment. However, this effect also brings back the YZ character of the whole pocket. So if you now you play with the orbital character, you again get a pocket which has dominant YZ character along at t equal to zero, which is not what you do see in the experiment. And this, of course, is a problem, but there is an advantage, again, of this approach, that you explain why the Y pocket is not seen in STM. This is a very important problem that is not completely solved, and different appers, people have different opinions. Maybe Sergei will tell more about this. Another nice approach, it will be probably described by Shimiao Si on Friday, is, again, to make a collation starting from multi-orbit DJ model, the slave spin approximation. Here, the spectral weights are not taken by hand, but they are computed microscopically. You get the right order that is consistent with this STM. And here, small anisotropy is enough to reproduce the gap. But again, why is that? Because also in this model, the YZ pocket is very large, has very large character at theta equal to zero. So this is, you have 8% of YZ character, while what you do see in the experiment is 18%. So of course, if you bring back the YZ character, it's easier to explain the anisotropy with a very small anisotropy in the orbital sector. Okay, just a final comment. As I told you, why, at least what is my belief, why all these models have so much difficulty to explain what's going on? Because the pneumatic effect in spin fluctuation, as it was asked before, comes from interaction beyond RPA. And then one has to work the problem hardly, especially including the spin degrees, the orbital degrees of freedom. We just did a recent work on this. We just I don't have time to give the detail, but just the idea is that in this kind of spin interaction model beyond RPA, Also, the orbital character of the pocket is very important, not only just the nesting property between hole like and electrolyte. And then also orbital nesting can be very, very important. And then the orbital mismatch that you have in iron selenium between the gamma and the electron pocket explaining why you can have a boost of nematicity and suppression of magnetism. And this can eventually explain what's going on essentially in iron selenium where you dope with sulfur. Okay. I don't have time to say this, let me just conclude. So the point we would try to pursue is that you can explain a lot of physics with the idea that you have a spin-mediated interaction with the hole-like electrolyte pocket, taking into account the orbital degrees of freedom. And the same mechanisms can explain different phenomena, the shrinking, which is temperature-dependent above TC, the reconstruction of the Fermi surface, and the gap hierarchy in the superconducting state. There are, of course, many more issues we are studying now, and this will probably appear soon. And with this, I conclude, and I thank you for your attention.
Thanks. Okay, we have time for questions. Yeah, go ahead.